During the 1800s, when hockey was still finding its roots, the first hockey puck would be created, but it would take time for it to reach its final form, as the first hockey puck ever created was rumored to be pieces of frozen cow dung. Yes, cow poo. However, the other option at the time was a wooden puck made out of branches of trees, or if you were lucky, you could use a stone or a small rock. It wasn't until around 1875 where hockey pucks would get their round shape, and by 1900, pucks would be made out of glued together tire rubber. Charles Goodyear is often credited for the creation of the puck we know of today, sorta. In 1839, Goodyear would invent vulcanized rubber. And years later, around 1900, a new method would be created by mixing vulcanized rubber with carbon black, creating the puck we know and love today. You most likely didn't know about this, and that's alright, as throughout this video, we'll be exploring even more strange and interesting facts about the league that you probably also didn't know about. We have a lot to get covered, so let's get right into it. When San Jose was awarded an NHL franchise in 1991, they, like most expansion teams, ran a fan poll asking for recommendations for a team name and logo. And also, like most teams, they got mixed results. But two in particular stand out to this day. The first is perhaps one of the most bizarre yet comedic finalists, as one of the final four names happened to be the San Jose Rubber Puckies. Just imagine a professional athlete skating out of the tunnel hearing chants of "Go Rubber Puckies." Perhaps they created a trend similar to the Florida Panthers rat throwing, where fans would instead throw rubber ducks onto the ice every time a goal was scored. The opportunities are endless, and the response by the media would be humiliating for the players. But speaking of response, another finalist, which technically was the winner, would have gotten an alarming response, especially by parents of younger children. So ownership thought, as the San Jose Blades was actually the winner of the fan poll. But ownership feared the team would draw uninvited ties to gang activity and violence, so the Gunn brothers would veto the name and would eventually decide on the San Jose Sharks, which, as we all know, was a decision for the better. When talking about NHL mascots, many tend to either bring up that the Rangers are the only team without one, or Gritty, but many tend to forget that one team actually had a live mascot at one point in time, and that team was the Pittsburgh Penguins. Unfortunately, we aren't talking about the 1995 sudden death mascot that dueled it out against Darren McCord. No, we're talking about Pittsburgh Pete, the mascot for the Penguins in the 1968 season, who was a real-life penguin. Pete would be introduced in a game against the Flyers after being loaned to the Pens as a birthday present for Jack McGregor's son. Pittsburgh Pete would make numerous live appearances throughout the season, eventually earning himself a pair of hockey skates. Unfortunately, Pittsburgh Pete would eventually retire due to old age, and the Penguins would later introduce Iceberg in 1993. We've heard of the Red Wings octopus throwing tradition and the sorta recent Predators catfish throwing tradition, but never have we actually seen live animals be thrown onto the ice on an almost daily basis. And those catfish and octopuses get thrown onto the ice once the players either stopped or a goal is scored. Well, in a game against the LA Kings and the Montreal Canadiens, many witnessed one of the most bizarre moments in NHL history when a live chicken would be thrown onto the ice. But this isn't even the best part, as the play never stopped once the chicken was thrown, which technically means that chicken would actually record time on ice. Once the whistle was finally blown, the commentators in the booth assumed the chicken was on the ice for about a minute and 15 seconds, making it the only animal to have ever technically played an NHL game. Of course, afterwards, the chicken would be taken off the ice, cape and all, and would be safely transported elsewhere, but not without leaving its mark, in more ways than one. We all know there was a Seattle team before the eventual Seattle Kraken, that being the Seattle Metropolitans, but what many don't know is that years after the Metropolitans would leave the NHL, Seattle would once again be awarded an NHL franchise, an expansion franchise, meaning that the Seattle Kraken aren't actually the first Seattle expansion team. The team would be awarded in 1974 to the owner of a minor league team called the Seattle Totems, and the plan was to have the team's inaugural season in the 1976-77 season. And believe it or not, the Seattle Totems were very popular in Seattle due to their many championship caliber squads over the years. However, the team would never even play an NHL game, as even after shooting promotional photos of the players in Totems jerseys, the group would miss numerous financial deadlines, making the Totems fold in 1975 without even making the NHL. Luckily, Seattle now has a chance to redeem themselves with the Kraken, and the city's been waiting a long time for a professional team, so hopefully this time, things pan out for the better. Before we begin this topic, this is a scenario I hope we never have to see pan out, as it's heartbreaking to read, let alone learn about. Basically, a disaster draft is a plan the league has in case of an unfortunate event in which five or more players pass away. This plan was put in place mainly due to the tragic Yaroslav locomotive plane crash that occurred during 2011, where the entire locomotive team would sadly pass away.
A former NHL player Pavel Dimitru was one of at least 43 people killed when a Russian jet carrying the locomotive hockey team crashed shortly after takeoff into a bank of the Volga River about 150 miles north of Moscow.
Once a disaster draft is triggered, the team would select players from other NHL teams in almost an expansion draft type fashion, where teams would protect one goaltender and 14 players. In some cases, a special draft can also be held, where the teams that weren't affected would protect one goaltender and 10 players. Essentially, a disaster draft is to replenish a roster affected due to a horrible event. A situation I hope I never have to see occur in the NHL, or at all for the remainder of my lifetime. Players get traded on the norm, and we've seen many get swapped this current offseason. But what we haven't seen, and haven't seen in a long while, is a member of the front office be traded. And believe it or not, what many do not know is that any member of a team's staff or front office can in fact be traded. And to blow your mind even further, there's been a time where this actually happened. In 1999, Rob Zominer, the captain of the Tampa Bay Lightning, would be traded to Ottawa in exchange for Andreas Johansson and the rights to negotiate with Senators GM Rick Dudley. Eventually, Dudley would accept the terms, and he would become the new GM of the Lightning. Although it hasn't happened since, the rule still exists and could very well happen, but now you can at least be prepared. We've previously talked about this trade in a previous video, but for those who are new, we'll rewind. In 1980, Leafs owner Harold Ballard was facing some pretty large financial issues and would propose an outlandish trade offer to Oilers owner Peter Pocklington, with a plan to have the Leafs play in Edmonton's new arena and the Oilers play in Maple Leafs Garden, essentially trading cities. However, believe it or not, both owners seemed okay with this deal, as moving to a big market like Toronto could increase the revenue due to the great one playing in town. Bauer would also include $50 million in cash as perhaps a sweetener, but ultimately decided to back out last minute for reasons unknown. But the fact that Pocklington was so ready for this deal to happen makes you wonder if it could have been brought up years later, and maybe they swapped cities down the road. Perhaps one of the craziest facts in this video is that there's a rule that states, quote, "If attempts to find suitable replacements are unsuccessful and teams can't agree on who would fill in, they shall appoint a player from each side who shall act as referee and linesman, the player of the home club acting as referee and the player of the visiting club as lineman." Basically, this rule means that if need be, players can be linesmen and referees in an NHL regular season game. And, well, what do you know? I was able to actually find a time where this actually happened. Although there is no footage of the players lacing up as linesmen, we do know that in a game against the Hartford Whalers and the New Jersey Devils in 1983, that Gary Howitt and Mickey Vulcan, two players from opposing teams who didn't lace up that night, would dress up and become referees for that night's game. Although it's very rare for something like this to occur, it's written for a reason, so perhaps maybe we'll see something like this happen once again in the future. One of the many facts the league likes to claim is that Sid the Kid would cap off the first ever outdoor game with a goal against the Sabres in the shootout. But the first outdoor game was actually in 1991 when the Kings played the New York Rangers in Caesars Palace in Las Vegas, Nevada.
The organizers at Caesars Palace hope tonight is the beginning of a new era in hockey. We're starting a project that actually began several years ago. And like everything else in Las Vegas, this one was also quite a gamble.
It was over 100 degrees that night, and the blue lines had to be frozen over the night of, and even when players stepped foot on the ice. The heat got so bad throughout the final 5 minutes of that game that it was reported that grasshoppers swarmed the ice. However, despite the conditions, the game was sold out, as the Kings would win the game 5-2, making almost what seems to be forgotten NHL history. If you know about or have heard about some other interesting or strange NHL facts, feel free to comment them down below. If you enjoyed, a subscribe would be appreciated. As always, I hope you're enjoying this deeper dive into hockey history. I'll catch you next time.